I'm Shivangi Chaturvedi, Digital Media Executive of Advantage India. I'm more than happy to welcome Mr. Satyam Agarwal as our guest for the evening. Before I say anything, I'm delighted and honored to have him as my guest today. When it comes to choosing a career, many people are at a dilemma for what to do. As a petroleum newcomer, we prefer to work in the petroleum industry rather than the IT industry. Today, we will discuss about the various opportunities, training, and future growth opportunities available in the IT industry. And before that, I'd like to briefly introduce our guest to all of you present. Satyam Agarwal is a senior consultant with 10 years of experience in E&P IT upstream, oil and gas, with the main focus on real-time data management, RTDM space. He is currently working as an upstream consultant in Infosys. He did his MBA in oil and gas management from UPES Dehradun. He has a keen understanding of upstream E&P IT industry, functional domain consulting, drilling and completions operations, LWD and MWD data, real-time data monitoring, WITs, data interpretation and validation, business analysis, system configuration, functional testing, and testing lifecycle. He has an agile mindset to focus on the changing and critical requirements, and he's capable of working in a complex multi-vendor and multi-stakeholder setup to quickly understand the business processes and work towards maximum value realization with an eye for the details. We are more than happy to have you, sir. You can take the mic now and go forward and tell us about your journey.
Yeah, thank you, Shivangi. That was a bit long introduction, but thank you anyways. So, good evening, everyone who has joined, and hopefully this session could be, you know, something you can take away something useful from this session. So, I haven't prepared any slide or anything, right? I mean, this is wanted to be more of a back and forth as much as we can. I'll just share what I've learned over the past 10 years. And I mean, as required, we can, you know, take some questions. Yeah, so I'll again not go into the details of my background, which Shivangi has just mentioned, so let's just focus on the topic. So now the topic of the day, I mean, as we all know, is why, you know, IT industry after doing petroleum. So to start with, I would just simply say that don't look at IT as something different or as a separate entity, right? In this connected world, IT is more than just an enabler. So if you look as 5 years or 10 years, you know, around 2005, 2010, at that time period, IT was considered to be, you know, more of an enabler. It's like good to have thing, but that scenario has changed now, and it's applicable to any industry, be it oil and gas or any industry. Specifically, if you look oil and gas, I'm not sure how many of you are aware of it, but as a member of oil and gas industry, you should be aware of is something called digital oil. So if you're not aware of it, I'll briefly touch upon that, but I would encourage everyone to just please go and read about it. A lot of material is available on the internet. Open source material is available. So digital oil field is basically the concept of incorporating the latest relevant IT technologies with the oil and gas day-to-day operations. The main idea is to basically take advantage of IT, make it more cost-effective, and thereby reduce the HSE incidents as well, which is a major part of our, right? So you see, I mean, this is just one of the examples which I gave, and this is not something, this is something, you know, some companies like BP or Shell or Chevron, these companies have been ahead of the curve and they have adopted IT for some time now, and they are reaping the benefits of it. There are other companies like Exxon and other mid-level operators who were not so open to IT, to adopting IT. But that the corona or the COVID situation has actually changed all. Now, going to IT or embracing IT is no more an option, or it's no more in a situation where where any company can say that, okay, we'll think about it. It's like you have to do it now. The degree to which each company adapts IT depends on their vision, depends on their business, and all those kind of things. But IT is an integral part of oil and gas. That's for sure that you can take in writing. That's IT is not going anywhere. My first point is, don't look at IT as something different than oil and gas, right? Now, coming to what would a petroleum engineer do? So I'll focus it mainly from the fisher's point of view. I mean, as in when you have certain experience in oil and gas industry, I mean, the situation changes, and that would be very diverse depending on what your background is. But as a fresher, if you are a petroleum engineer, you can start looking into it as an option to get into the industry. For example, if you don't get into any core business company, right? It's getting into an IT company who are executing oil and gas projects is definitely an advantage for you. It will give you a double advantage in the sense, first of all, if you work with an IT company, and of course, in a project where oil and gas is involved, right? So you will definitely learn about the oil and gas business, because what you learn in college is totally different from what you see in the actual corporate life. That is one thing. Another part is you will get exposed to IT aspects of business, which is again very essential. You cannot survive, or at least if you survive, it will be very difficult to actually progress in your career if you don't focus on IT. And when I say IT, I don't mean that you have to discard your petroleum engineering or you totally have to focus on IT. What I'm trying to say is you have to have that mindset that I have certain domain understanding. I understand petroleum, I understand oil and gas. How can I incorporate IT into that? That mindset is actually very important. And so if you see 10, 15 years ago, when companies like Infosys or any other IT company, right, whenever they approached any oil and gas company to say that, okay, we can execute this project for you, this IT project. The clients, mainly which were European, Middle Eastern, or American oil and gas companies, their question was, what do you know about our business? Which is a very, very genuine question. Now, in IT industry, there are a lot of people who have a very good understanding of IT, who have spent a lot of time, in fact, their entire career in IT, but they don't have that oil and gas background. That's when these companies, started recruiting people or started, visiting colleges who had, that kind of manpower who could provide these kind of people who understand business, oil and gas business as well. So now when these people, the petroleum engineers or people who have been in the field or who have oil and gas background, now when these people go and talk to the business, to the client, right? Now the client has more trust and understanding of, okay, now I'm talking to a person who at least understands oil and gas, right? And then again, of course, you will bring your IT understanding or IT, understanding to that as well. So that's actually a very good mix. So one thing you have to keep in mind is whether you are in core business, and of course, if you are in IT, there is no, or there is a very limited scope of a pure IT guy or a pure domain guy. But those boundaries are very blurred these days. What you have to have is you need to have a techno-functional mindset. And by that, I mean you need to understand the business. Whatever domain you are in, we are in oil and gas. So of course, we'll be talking about oil and gas. But this is relevant for any industry in general. You need to understand your industry, what is going on there, what is the latest trends. That is definitely very important. And side by side, what is the IT aspects of it? How can we execute this? Give you an example. I think most of the people will be aware of it. How IT is an integral part of oil and gas. It has been for some time now. I'll give you two examples. One is very basic. I mean, you would know while I'm working it, right? Earlier when we used to lower that instrument in the hole and then it used to record the data, and then we used to pull that instrument out, then we used to interpret that data, record that data, and then it usually took two days to 1 week depending on various factors. Now we have something called LWD, which is logging while drilling and measurement while drilling. The whole concept is, as in when you are drilling a well, you can capture the subsurface current at that point of time immediately. That is a very big advantage. So you would understand, like at the rig site, the equipments or the rig that the operator has leased, it can vary from $10,000 to $1,00,000 or $100,000 per day, depending on the location and size of it. That's a very big money. Now, if you have to wait 1 week, let's say 3 days, just to get that data, capture that data and interpret that data, make sense out of that data. Basically, your $300,000 is gone to waste, right? Now, if you can have that data immediately and share that, capture that data, store that data, transmit that data to someone, let's say a senior drilling engineer or research supervisor who is, let's say, not at the drilling site, but sitting in a Houston office or a London Sunbury office, can provide that data to that person immediately and he can take a critical decision. Basically, you are saving that much money and time. That is the aspect, or that is the impact of IT. Right. Give you another example is, basically I was involved in a project, is extension of what I just gave you an example, where there was a software called WellAdvisor. The idea was to basically monitor every aspect of drilling and completion, right from casing, right from drilling to casing to cementing, to pressure testing and installing BOP, everything. So each and every component has a separate console, where it captured the key KPIs or parameters of that operation. And that operation could be happening in Gulf of Mexico, that could be happening in North Sea, that could be happening in Azerbaijan, Angola, Egypt, anywhere, depending on where the operation is happening. But the person who, senior drilling engineer or a geologist or a well site supervisor, whoever, they might be not available at that site. They might be sitting in London, because people in this industry, they work in shifts. So now if these people can get that data immediately, they can take that information and interpret that data, provide their inputs, and the operation can continue. So that is the impact of it. And during this project, which I just mentioned, basically I'm just trying to emphasize the impact of IT. Because of this real-time monitoring of that casing operation, the client was able to reduce the stuck casing incidents by almost 80%, because they were able to monitor the real-time casing operation real-time in as and when it is happening, and they were able to take corrective measures. And because of that, they were able to save over a period of, I say, let's say 5 years, they were able to save $700,000 just because of that stuck casing, which is a lot of money for any company, right? Why would they, why are they, investing in IT just for these advantages? Otherwise, they have people who will take care of it. If there is a stuck casing, there are drilling engineers who will take care of it. But then if you can get that information beforehand, it can be resolved in real time. So that is the impact of IT, what I'm trying to tell you. So all in all, what I'm trying to say is, people who are from petroleum industry, don't look at IT as something, as a separate entity. I have done petroleum engineering, why should I learn IT? Whether you join in core company, whether you join a services company, for example, Schlumberger, Halliburton, Aker, or these kind of companies, or you join a service, companies like Infosys, Wipro, Accenture, TCS. So there are different layers to it, but at each layer, IT will be expected out of it. That is that you can be sure of it. So if you are in a core business company, let's say ONGC in India, India's context, or let's say BP or Chevron or Exxon, right, in European or American context. You are, depending on your role, IT might be a little less, but eventually it will be there. If you join a companies like service operators like Halliburton or Schlumberger or Aker or companies like this, your involvement in IT will be a little more, definitely, because these companies have their proprietary softwares, you know, which require a lot of IT. And then, of course, if you join companies like Infosys, Wipro, Accenture, these kind of company service providers, then your level of involvement in IT will be totally different. But at each level, your level of involvement will be. And again, I would like to emphasize that when I say IT, you have to embrace IT. I don't mean that you have to be an expert. You have to be an expert in coding, or you have to be a database administrator, nothing like that. All you have to have is an open mindset and an understanding, okay, how a system works. If tomorrow you get a code, you should be able to understand it, what it's trying to say. You're not supposed to write a code from scratch. You're not supposed to write a SQL query, 10-page SQL from scratch. If you can do that, that's of course well and good. If you cannot do that, at least you should have that mindset to understand what this piece of code is telling me, what this piece of query is telling me, so that you can get on with your work. That is the expectation from a petroleum engineer in IT. As I said, there is no escape. So as soon as you embrace it, work on it, that will be beneficial for you. I think I've made that clear. Anything else, I'm ready to.
Yeah, since you already discussed about why going to the core is not necessary. You know, yeah. We see in the placement students, we don't want to sit in the IT companies. We just want to go to the core. That's what we discussed. Any questions from the audience, you can place them in the chat box. Till then, I would like to proceed with my question. Would you like to throw light upon the culture of Infosys, sir? You know, the opportunities and the training situation that goes around, especially when we talk of the freshers. So how does the company go about that?
Right. So, I mean, specifically focusing on freshers. So, of course, Infosys hires directly from the colleges like PDP. So they have this yearly campus interviews where they hire petroleum engineers. And of course, I think most people will know that Infosys has the biggest corporate training university in the world, right? So that the Mysore campus, which is famous for its training, it's actually the biggest corporate training campus or university, you can say, in the world. So once the training or, you know, the person joins through campus, and I'm talking about BTech freshers, they will undergo, you know, kind of 3 months training, intensive training, which will be primarily IT driven. You know, they will not be taught any oil and gas or anything. It will be purely IT, different components of IT. And as and when they graduate, right, they are moved to production, which is life projects. They are mapped to life projects. And primarily these, they are mapped to LMS projects. That could be your upstream project. That could be your project related to GIS. That could be a downstream project. I mean, depending on the requirement. As and when these people join the production or the mapped project, again, they are given the necessary training. Let's say, for example, if any proprietary software is being used, which of course cannot be taught in a training setup, overall training setup. So if you are required to work on that project, again, you are trained on that project by the people who are actually product for a long time. And then of course you are expected to work on that. And as I said, depending on what kind of technology you have been trained on, of course you'll be utilizing that. And you'll be working on that software, which is basically a software or application or whatever that is required for your project. That is the initial journey of how a fresher is, you know, onboarded and trained, and how they are mapped to a project. As and when, you know, you start working in over a period of time, you show potential, you show understanding of the overall, you know, working environment and project. And so you are, of course, promoted and progressed. And as in when you know you grow in your role, more responsibility comes, and of course along with responsibility your rewards come. So that's a general career progression process, I would say, which is pretty much similar, I guess, in other industries as well. Only difference would be, I think, to an extent, would be the level of training that you get. It might vary from organization to organization, because you know the trainings and all are very much project driven or requirement driven. So the kind of training that, let's say, Infosys is giving might not, you know, another company might not be giving, because they don't need it. They might need something else. So all in all, this is a general a way a career progresses in IT company or any profession.
So this was about the training. Now for an outsider, for a fresher to start it, how can one, you know, just excel at this? I mean, if they start with the training and running from day one, if we talk about, how can one just be, you know, excel at it and just have a brilliant focus so that the progression that you're talking about, that comes easy?
It's not easy in the sense that it's not difficult, I would say. But as I said, what you need to have is, and frankly speaking, I have interacted with a lot of freshers who have joined my project. And eventually this question, what you have initially asked me, right? So I'm a petroleum engineer, why am I working in IT? Why am I working? This eventually comes up. It's nothing new. And the explanation that I gave, a long explanation that I gave, basically that's what we try to tell them. Eventually you are in an IT company. You have to keep in mind, your background is petroleum engineering, but eventually you are in an IT company. So the maximum projects you will get, or most of the projects that you will get, it will have IT flavor to it. Some might have less, some might will have more, that can vary from project to project. But before you enter the industry, you have to keep in mind, you have to make your mind that you are entering an IT company, right? So IT will be there, it's not going anywhere. As soon as you accept it, work on it, keep an open mind, as I said, and be comfortable with, you know, technology. It's not going to harm you anyways. Excel at it, it's not going to harm you. So if you have that kind of mindset, and people, you know, people above you see that, okay, this person, he has a nice, he or she has a nice blend of that technology plus domain understanding, that will definitely open a lot of doors. But if you show resistance, I mean, again, you may have your genuine concerns, right? You may not like a project. You may want to change your stream or whatever. Those are all genuine things. But if you have decided to join an IT company and then you say, no, I'm not willing to work on it, that actually, you know, doesn't sit well with people, right? Because companies as well have invested on you. And it's your conscious decision that you have decided, okay, I want to. I've seen a lot of people, and recently we have recruited a lot of people, laterals, right, who have spent, let's say, 4 or 5 years in the field, who have actually worked in oil and gas. And over a period of time, what they realize is this industry is not for me. I mean, I'm talking about the core oil and gas. Reason being, again, it's a ship-based career. You have to stay a lot of time away from your family, as you know. You are at the drilling site where your family cannot stay. You have to work, let's say, 28 days in a row, and then you get a work on 15 days or a 20 days day off. So, I mean, all those looks good, you know, and everything is fine. But over a period of time, it wears you down, you know. Not a lot of people can cope up with that kind of environment. So over a period of time, they realize, okay, this industry is not for me. I want to go back to IT industry. Which is comparatively, you know, I'm not saying it is easy, but comparatively, at least you won't have that, okay, you have to stay away from your family for 28 days and stuff like that. So it happens both ways. I've seen freshers who have not experienced the industry and they say, no, I want to go to core, okay, fine. And I've seen laterals who have been part of industry and they come back and say, no, this is not, I want to go back to something more, you know, reasonable. So it goes both ways. But as I said, you have to keep an open mind. Whatever industry you choose, whether you choose the core industry or you choose IT industry, we try to learn as much as possible. That is the only way you can survive. Once you switch the industry, I mean, whatever you have learned, that will definitely come in handy. That's what I can say. So for freshers, I would suggest one more thing apart from keeping an open mind is read about your industry. Read as much as you want. There's a lot of information. Try to understand IT, oil and gas, not just as a career prospect, but as an industry, what is happening in oil and gas? Okay, why did you choose oil and gas? That is a basic question you have to ask. Why did you choose petroleum engineering? Did something about it excite you? Or did you want to learn more about it? Or was it just, you know, you found it glamorous, or you read somewhere or someone pushed you? I mean, different people have different motivations. That's all right. Point is that you should be aware of your industry. That is that, and keeping an open mind, that will basically open a lot of doors.
We have a question from the audience. I also wanted to ask that, what are the must needed skills for a petroleum engineer to get into IT? I mean, the diverse skill set that one requires. So
is it again focused for freshers, or it is for laterals as well?
We can discuss about both. I guess we have both in the audience right now. Okay. Freshers as well as.
Okay, let's start with the freshers. For freshers, as I said, in general, see, again, this is a very diverse thing. I cannot, in fact, no one can comment that you go and learn this and it will make your life easy. In general, what I would say is you need to have 2-3 things sorted out, which is very basic. First is, of course, your command or whatever your core is, right? Whatever your subject you find interesting, you should have a thorough command on it. Because when you say I am from industry or I am from oil and gas, again, it's a very diverse, a very big industry. You should have at least one or two focus areas where you can talk confidently. Okay, it could be anything. For freshers, it's not expected much. I'll come to the laterals a bit. But for freshers, it is not expected, okay, that you go and talk about this particular topic. Mostly for them, it's like, okay, what you know, what are your areas of interest? And it's such a wide industry, right? It could be an exploration. It could be your drilling and completions. It could be your hydrocarbon allocation. It could be your transportation. It could be refining or petrochemical, anything. Whatever it could be reservoir engineering. Whatever you find you are comfortable with, whatever interests you. And if you say this is my interest, you should have at least some kind of command over it, right? I mean, in the sense, of course, you cannot be an expert. That is understandable. But it should not be like, okay, you want to talk about this one and then you know, kind of fizzle out. That is one important thing. This other aspect which I want to say, and it is in a very generalized way, is have a decent understanding of three things in terms of IT. One is any object-oriented language, right? Again, I'm not saying in terms of that you have to be a master coder, you have to be a developer, nothing of the sort. But at least you should be aware of what is an object-oriented language, what are the different flavors of it. Currently, for example, Python is latest in the market, which is everywhere. Understand the basics of Python. What is Python? What does it do? How can it help, right? So understand that. Second is have an understanding of a database. And by a database, I mean a relational database. These days, there are NoSQL databases as well. But I mean, that is something, if you can invest time on that, that's fine. But at least you should know about your relational databases. Again, basics of that. 2-3 things are very important in that. One is, what are the basic DDL, DML commands? Your insert, update queries, and delete, drop queries. So basically your DDL and DML commands. And second is your joins, basically your inner join, outer join, left join, right join. So plus, again, you have to have a basic understanding of what is a schema, what is a table, what is a view, what is a trigger. So these are the database related concepts, which again, you should be aware of, and it will help you. I mean, you're going to be part of IT industry. Database is something you cannot live without. whatever application you work, whatever stream you work on, database is something good, will always be good. You should have a basic understanding of any database. And third is, again, it's an optional thing, but it's good to have these days. It's to have an understanding of a visualization tool. And by that, I mean tools like Power BI or a Tableau or a ClickSense or something like that, where you can, you know, kind of gather large data and present it in a meaningful way. So if you have these three things in terms of IT, and I'm talking about from the Trisha's point of view, I'm not talking about any specific tool. These are just very generic things you can go and explore. These are must. If you are going for a campus interview, if you are going, you know, for an off-campus interview, especially for an IT company, you can expect questions and people would want you to have, again, a decent understanding of. That is from the Trisha's point of view. From lateral point of view, again, what I just said, this holds true for them as well. Having an understanding of object-oriented language, a database, and a visualization tool will definitely help you, you know. And of course, whatever you know, track you have worked on, if you have worked as a MWD, so what are the different, you know, aspects of MWD as a career? What have you done? What are the different tools used in the industry which you have worked, right? If you have worked as a reservoir engineer, okay, what have you done? Your resume, basically, right? What have you done? You should be thorough in them. For lateral, since they would have worked on certain, you know, areas, so have a good understanding of that area and what kind of tools you have used in that area. And of course, this thing which I said from the IT perspective, that will give you an edge over.
We have questions coming up that basically are pointing towards any off-campus opportunities if available for 1 year experience or 2 year experience or even freshers.
Yeah, I mean, these opportunities keep coming in. I mean, it's a bit, you know, difficult compared to the lateral entry or a freshers entry, right? Campus interview, but they do keep coming in. So what, for that you can basically visit their company websites, or you can reach out to the people who are actually working there and have a networking with them, right? So get the understanding, okay, what is happening in that particular company. So I'm not sure, but if you are aware, like in these, at least for last 6 months, right, there is a kind of talent war going on, which is basically everyone is kind of, you know, there is a war for talent. Companies are literally hiring in thousands, freshers and experienced people for the areas. So I would suggest you go and talk to people who are actually working in those companies and try to understand what their requirements. Simply just don't go and say, you know, is there a job opening? I mean, that will not work. You have to go and understand, okay, what does that company do? And what it does it match with your experience or your qualification, right? At sometimes what it happens is there are openings, right? But it doesn't match with your qualification or what you have done. So that is not going to help you. Or simply it's like, okay, you message someone on the LinkedIn or anywhere, right? I would say how you make your pitch, how you make your sales pitch, whether you are selling anything, or you are selling your resume, that matters a lot. Simply just don't go. For example, you are going, any freshers going to message you, do you have an opening in process? Now, what should I reply? I don't know you. What are your skills? What can you bring to the table? If I am going to refer you, if I'm going to talk to anyone in my company, okay, this guy wants a job or he's looking for a job, their question, okay, what is his skill set? When you approach someone, who it could be in person, it could be virtually, wherever, have a pitch ready and try to customize it. I see a lot of people, you know, kind of, they have a ready-made two-line pitch. They keep on sending it to everyone. Okay, fine. I mean, there are limitations. But these are the basic things which you can, kind of do to improve your chances. I'm not saying this is going to get you a job. All I'm saying is, getting a favorable response is much more possible if you do this kind of thing. So again, keep an eye on the, you know, websites, talk to people, network, and network in a meaningful way. That's what I'm trying to say. If you're approaching someone, don't expect them to do the groundwork for you. You have to do your research. You have to find out, okay, this is the opening. Can you please refer me? These are my qualifications. I've done this, 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 and I find myself suitable for this. So that person is more likely to, you know, answer you back. Okay, this person has taken the made an effort to actually do some groundwork. Let me help him. So that is, you know, there is a various aspects of how you go about searching your job or approaching people. That kind of thing you have to do.
So if we move forward towards, you know, the job description of a technical consultant, what exactly is the role, as in how a consultant helps in developing the projects for oil and gas companies, and how during the career progression the responsibilities change? If you could ponder over that.
Yeah, so basically, as I said, these days the demand, or you are expected to be a techno-functional consultant. There is, you know, in terms of oil and gas, if I say the kind of background we have, right? We are from the domain side, and then you are doing a kind of IT work. Pure technical consulting is not required from our side, or most people won't do that. What they do is basically they transition into something called analyst, which is basically, you know, you are put in a project, you have to understand, okay, what is going on in the project. What is the requirement from the client? You have to document that. You have to have a clear understanding of what is the future roadmap will be, where are the roadblocks, and what we can do to mitigate that. And that will come based on your kind of experience in whatever area you have worked. So that is the major role which I see in terms of technical consulting. You can say more or less it's a technical consulting. And then, of course, based on your domain experience, you can suggest, okay, this. If there is a process change required, it's a better way of doing something, you can always suggest that. But the primary idea is the kind of project you are working on. So primarily in IT industry, there are four kind of projects. There could be a support project. Support project is basically a project which is already running, and you kind of support the client in smooth running. There could be an enhancement project where, you know, there is a software, there is a tool already working condition, and there are certain enhancements to be made. You have to ensure that whatever is actually working, it doesn't breaks. Whatever is extra is required, it gets added on to that. That is the enhancement kind of project. And then, of course, there is a kind of a consulting, which is consulting is basically some new ideas which you pitch to the client, okay. Which, of course, which is not expected from a fresher. That will come over a period of time when you have a decent understanding of the client business, overall oil and gas business. You understand the different processes, what is going on. So typically, over after 8-10 years, or maybe more than that, depending on the complexity of the project, you can do that kind of consulting as well, where you have a deep understanding of what is happening and how can it be made better. So these are typically different kinds of projects which happen in a IT company. So depending on that, so your role for a fresher or for even for a lateral, right, the role will vary. For a fresher, you would be an independent individual team member. You will be assigned certain tasks which you have to do along with your teammates. As you progress, you are made, you know, maybe kind of a team lead, where you have to, you know, alongside your work, you have to manage a small team maybe. Then you can progress as a consultant or a senior consultant, even as a project manager. So over a period of time, basically, you know, as in when you develop your skills, as in when you develop the core competencies of both oil and gas and IT, different responsibilities are given, which grows over a period of time, right? So initially in your phase, there might be minimum client interaction, right? You are maybe the face of the project. But as you grow, expectation would be to, you know, handle a client, talk to them on a daily basis, ensure that everything is working fine. Any new requirements, what can you do about it? Maybe pitch a new idea. Okay, this is something we can do for you extra, right? So all those things will happen gradually over a period of time as and when you grow. This is a typical, you know, career progression for any engineer, I would say. For a petroleum engineer, only thing that varies is basically you are mapped to an oil and gas project for which you need to have a deep understanding. That is the difference, I would say.
So I will take my last question for the session. How do you feel the dynamics of the consulting industry, we talk in particular, have changed because of the artificial intelligence and the machine learning static, which is common? And how has that changed, if I talk of the deliverables by the company and as well as the client expectations from the company? So what are your views on that?
Yeah, so basically, AI and ML, again, has become an integral part of our daily lives, not just oil and gas, but everywhere you go, AI ML is basically everywhere. And oil and gas is no exception. Again, I'm not sure how many of you would have heard, but there is something called digital twin. I would again encourage you, everyone, to go ahead and read about it. But digital twin is basically, you know, in terms of oil and gas, is basically the idea or the concept of having a virtual representation of your physical assets, right? What it helps is basically it will help you to build deep analytics over that virtual object, analyze that object, and build different kind of models. So basically, if you have a physical object, there are certain things, there are certain limitations to which you can, what you can do with it, right? Even if it is not working properly, or there is some problem with it, you want to do some kind of analytics with it, there are certain limitations to what you can do. But if you have a virtual representation of the same object, right, you can do endless number of things with it. You can analyze it any way you want. You can build like what if, what will kind of model, right? Basically, you can build your hypothesis. Okay, I want to do this and see the impact of that, which is very much possible with a virtual object, but it's not always possible with a physical actual object. So it's a very interesting thing, and AI ML is a very integral or important piece of this entire strategy. And different companies call it with a different name. For example, BP calls it Apex, Equinor calls it Epoch, or Eco, I guess. Yeah, sorry, Eco. Equinor calls it Eco. So again, just go ahead and read about all these things, which will give you a perspective of how the overall oil and gas industry is changing and how it is leveraging your AI ML, which is, again, as the time progresses, it will be more critical. I mean, the integral part of it. So I just gave you one example. There are many examples of how AI ML is going on. So deep learning, natural language processing, all those things are slowly becoming part of it. I gave you an example of a support project, right, in IT industry. In support projects, what usually happens is there are a lot of tickets, right? So if a business faces some kind of issue, they will log a ticket and it is routed to a team. Team will work on it, resolve it, and issue is resolved. Now, earlier what used to happen is, some person need to, address that ticket, right? Now we have built a kind of, most of the companies have built a kind of, robots, we call it bots, piece of softwares, which basically over a period of time, it captures all different kinds of ticket, analyzes that ticket, build analytics on top of that. And over a period of time, it can help you build a repository, knowledge repository, right? So all those things are possible. There are various aspects to AI and ML, and oil and gas is, some of the companies, not all, some of the companies are actually at the forefront of making that something more meaningful. So again, this is all about, you can go ahead and read about it, and it will definitely help you to build a good understanding.
That was all for the questions that I had. One last question we have in the audience. Adding current question, what is your perspective to join company as data scientist, not only in oil industry, but in general? I guess he is trying to ask about joining into any company as a data scientist.
Yes, you can definitely join. Data scientists are definitely in demand these days, but it will depend a lot on what is your background, what have you actually done, because data scientist is a senior role, which will which will definitely require a lot from you. If you aspire to be a data scientist, which is good, which is actually future of this one, but then you have to build a deep understanding of different methodologies, different languages that you have to be aware of, different data models that you have to be aware of, different architecture that you have to be aware of. So it is a very wide field. I would say data scientist is, it's a very wide field. Out of that, based on your interest and based on your comfort level, you have to actually choose where you want to go, whether the analyst within a data scientist, whether you want to natural language processing, whether you want to do a text to speech conversion, or you want to build some, you know, some different kind of models for the industry. So I mean, there are different facets or different aspects of it. It's a very wide area, and of course, as I said, it's a senior role. So something you would have, you need to have something to show for that. This is something I have done, and I qualify for a data scientist role. And companies, as I said, IT companies would definitely have these kind of openings. People with these kind of qualifications are very limited. So you have a good opportunity as well if you have a good understanding of these concepts.
So though you've covered almost everything, at the end, any concluding statement you'd like to give to everybody who's there in the audience? Be it a fresher moving towards the industry or anybody.
I mean, I would just like to reiterate, I mean, there's nothing new which I can add, but I would just like to reiterate that, the whole industry, not just oil and gas, even IT industry is going through a lot of churn, a lot of, changes are happening within IT industry. What you have to do is basically you have to prioritize. You have to actually make your mind like which area you want to go. No industry is bad. Every industry has its challenges, it has its perks, it has its drawbacks. So it's not like if you are in oil and gas, you are missing something out, or if you are in IT, you are missing something out. It's all about perspective and where you want to go. What you need is different industries need different kind of approach to be successful. For that, you have to build a kind of mindset. You have to do kind of a research. Okay, this is the area I want to go, and these are the competencies that I need to build. For example, if you want to go in this core company, right, and you want to be a drilling engineer, okay, what are the different courses that I need to do other than my college degree, right, to be a good drilling engineer? What are the certifications that I need to do? Or how do you see yourself 5 years, 10 years down the line? See, I understand these are very cliche questions, right? Any company you would go, they will ask, where do you see yourself 5 years down the line? But you need to have that kind of vision, or at least that kind of planning. Where do you see yourself? And if you don't see yourself in that industry over a period of 5-10 years, then it's better not to be part of it. That's an individual take. Similarly for IT industry. IT industry has its perks, but you have to be aware that it's a very fast changing industry, right? So what is relevant today, whatever skill is relevant today, might not be relevant tomorrow, right? So that is, again, you have to be aware of it. You have to be very agile. You have to be constantly keep on learning new things, exploring new things. And so basically, again, what I'm trying to emphasize is you have to have that kind of mindset, whichever industry you choose. Do a kind of research on it. Okay, these are the different tracks. These are different areas I can go ahead. Talk to people who are part of that industry if you don't understand yourself. Talk to people. And then make up your mind. One thing, fresher, and even I mean, everyone does that when they are, don't have that industry experience. We have very rigid or a fixed mindset. Okay, I will do only this. This is the best for me. Don't know this, whether that is best for you or not. I mean, you have not yet started your career. So explore different areas, but keep an open mind. If you don't like it, change it. But then, of course, you need to have some kind of groundwork prepared for that. So these are the things I would say. And again, if you have any questions, you can me. I'm available on LinkedIn. I'm happy to just answer your queries, whatever I know. And not just me. I mean, I am sure everyone would know different people working in IT industry or anything. You can talk to them, try to understand. And that should answer your
Okay, thank you. On that, we come to an end of the podcast. Thank you, sir, for taking a part of your weekend and devoting it to the podcast. I'm sure everybody got to learn a lot from you today. As sir said, any queries, you can either reach out to him, anybody, or you can also mail us. And as I said in the beginning, if you have any queries regarding the internship program, the two-month internship program I talked about, Bell Engineering, you can also reach out to us on our mail ID or anywhere on any platform. The recorded session for the podcast would be available on our YouTube channel. So you can go there and have a look if any of you or your friends have missed it. And with that, I'd like to end the podcast as well. And thank you once again, sir, for being
thank
there
you.
With us. Everybody, please stay safe and get yourselves vaccinated as soon as possible. We sure would be right back with another podcast another weekend. Thank you so much, everybody. I'll take care.
Thank you, and have a good day. Have a good weekend.